In today's lecture, we are going to discuss about what effect women's franchise rights has had on electoral politics all over the world. For this, we are first going to discuss the contradictions which gave rise to the women's franchise movement and how women's franchise later has affected politics in India, in Japan, in USA, and in Germany. Basically, the women's franchise movement arose from the inherent contradictions that were there between the individual and the gendered boundaries that neatly demarcated the public domain from the private one. The relationship between social movements and citizenship can be understood as completely reciprocal. That is to say that only social movements can actually give rise to informed citizens who will in turn make demands on the state to improve their lives, to make more development-oriented plans, as well as take care of the welfare of the entire state. This does not mean that only the male members of the state will be participating in the decision-making process. Because if that is the case, then nearly 50% of the population is left behind and their welfare is not taken into consideration. Therefore, when the West started thinking about democracy, started formulating plans of democracy, started practicing liberalism as a part of their national policy, it was important for women to be also given the right to vote. This process, as we had seen in an earlier lecture, was not an easy one. It went through many ups and downs before women in the Western world gained the right to vote. On the other hand, if we look at the third world countries, which were former colonies of several European nations, we will find a surprising trend there. The right to vote, or rather, universal franchise, came to be equated somehow with the national movement for freedom. But what we have to keep in mind is the fact that the experience of the first world country women was not same as, say, the experience of a woman in rural India or in Japan. That is why there could not be one universal model to decide how women were to go about gaining their right to vote and later on have a positive and definite say in state policies. In fact, while commenting on the nature of the women's suffragist movement all over the world, Halliday had stated, "The personal is international." Another interesting aspect that we have to keep in mind is that the question of women's rights or the issue of women is not only a political one now. It has percolated the realm of theory, the realm of philosophy, and it addresses not just the daily struggles that women face as the discriminated gender, but also entire humanity. In fact, women as the discriminated gender are not the only victims of an oppressive patriarchy. Even men are equal victims, whereby they have to fulfill certain roles which are gender specific and which have been imposed on them. This limits their potential, as well as limits their scope to express themselves, perhaps in roles which are not really male-oriented. To understand this entire concept better, what we will be doing is taking a look at four different nation states, India, Japan, USA, and Germany. What is interesting to note here is the fact that women in India did not have to wage a separate battle to gain the right to vote. The right to universal adult franchise was easily contained within the larger framework of the independence movement. That is why, when India became independent, all adults in India were given the right to vote, irrespective of their gender or educational qualification. And in spite of this great advantage, what is actually quite disappointing is that women in India may have got the right to vote, but if we talk about their participation in the actual political process, apart from voting, it is quite limited. What is it that keeps Indian women away from being politically active? Indian women are traditionally considered as nurturers, as mothers, as people who kept the hearth and who took care of their menfolk. Even if they went to vote, they did so generally under the guidance of the menfolk of their family. There has been many an attempt to bring more and more women into the political process. The 73rd Amendment to the Constitution introduced reservation for women in panchayats to up to 33%. This was done to actually bring more rural women into the political scenario so that they could effectively bring about certain changes not only in their personal lives but also in the entire community. However, what we actually experience as a result of this 33% reservation of seats is the fact that in the village panchayats, women are mostly appointed and not elected. Say, for example, a powerful family of perhaps the village pradhan will put either his wife or his daughter-in-law in the panchayat. Actually, the case is that he would be running the show through his female relative. That is why this 33% reservation is an issue that does not have too many takers. And yet we cannot deny the fact that among so many women elected every 5 years in the panchayats, there will be a few thousand who will take up issues on their own without any male guidance. It is on these women that we depend to bring about positive changes, not only in their community, but also their state and eventually at the national level. There are many issues that are being addressed more actively now. And through this process, women in India have started challenging the invisible patriarchy without being co-opted into the process. Nevertheless, the changes that these policies have brought about are piecemeal and uneven. For example, in a recent survey done by an NGO named Alochana, it has been found out that politically active women in India are sure of their demands and their ideas and can contradict the state and take it head on with confidence. But when it comes to practicing their public beliefs in their private space, they are utter failures. Thus, in order to make these issues more pertinent for society and to formulate policies, say against underemployment, uneven wage payment, or equal education, or measures against domestic violence, it is important for not only the woman to be informed, but also the man to be aware of these evils. It is up to the state to make the mass aware of what it perceives as gender-specific problems, as not being just gender-specific, but having a larger reach. Much like India, Japan is severely patriarchal. Women naturally did not have the right to vote up to 1945. And yet, after the Meiji Restoration of 1868, Japan was flooded with Western ideas of liberalism, democracy, and personal freedom. Some historians and political theorists claim that this flood of ideas is what made Japan aware of the issue of women's right to vote. Others, on the other hand, believe that it was the Japanese government in the early 20th century which actually initiated the change. What really happened is what we are going to discuss next. But before that, we have to realize that though Japan had opened her gates to Western ideas and was more receptive about the ideas of liberalism or democracy or personal freedom, the women in Japan did not have the same degree of freedom that the women in UK or America had. What they had to deal with was patriarchal Confucian ideas and samurai code of conduct. The woman was considered to be foremost a mother and then anything else. If she could vote or if she could sell property, it was only with the permission of her husband. Thus, even after gaining voting rights in 1945, women in Japan failed to make an impact that could change their lives as well as change how the community behaved. The idea of women's right to vote was first taken up in Japan in 1931 by the cabinet of Prime Minister Hamaguchi Osachi. Since his cabinet was completely independent of the legislature, it was possible for him to introduce a bill which would give women above the age of 25 the right to vote under the guidance of their fathers or their husbands. Naturally, this bill was passed by the lower house, but it was stalled by the peers who felt that women would be now transcending into the traditional male area. Of course, the ministry of Hamaguchi Osachi did not think of equating men and women on an equal platform. What they tried to do was involve more women in the political process so as to remain relevant for the public. Because the government was involved in giving women the right to vote, the entire concept was seen as honorable as well as part of the national policy. Nevertheless, women were allowed to vote only in cities and villages and could also hold offices if their husbands permitted. Nevertheless, events took a different turn with the Manchurian uprising when civil rights had to be suspended. It was an atmosphere of general unrest and military intervention, and most of the people in Japan had to give up their rights so as to ensure the security of their state. Women here figured nowhere. While they had been given the right to vote in cities and in villages, they were now completely relegated into the private space as non-entities. Only after the Allied occupation in the 1940s did the women of Japan take up their problems and their issues as a coherent movement. In 1946, women in Japan voted for the first time under the Allies. And thereafter, they started certain reform works which were not only meant for the upliftment of their community, but also for the entire nation which had been war-ravaged. What is interesting to note here is the fact that women in Japan did not equate themselves with their men. Actually, they never asked for equal rights. All they wanted was to participate in the process of making their community better. That is why women in Japan came up with organizations which were dedicated to relief, to providing relief to war-ravaged families, to war widows, to orphans, and also to provide education and health care. In fact, Japan to this day remains one of the developed countries which does not have equal gender relations. Perhaps the reason lies in the fact that society in Japan is inherently patriarchal to a large extent, so much so that the women themselves subscribe to this patriarchal idea. America is definitely different from the rest of the world as far as the process of granting women the right to vote is concerned. The women of America gained the right to vote in 1920, but this right was considered piecemeal because not all women could vote, and even if they did vote, they had to do it under the guidance of their fathers or their husbands. That is why this right, when it was granted, has been under a lot of scrutiny and has been dissected socially, politically, as well as morally. What stands out is the fact that though women in America gained the right to vote, it hardly brought about any positive change in their private space or in their public space. This right was dismissed as a minor one. What was done to analyze it was look at how many women voted, how many actually turned up. Did their vote churn out results which were unexpected? Did they vote because their husbands and their fathers asked them to vote? And other such similar questions. What is important for us to understand is not the quantitative aspect of women voting in America. It is true that till 1970, women's right to vote in America was definitely considered minor because it did not churn out results the kind that were expected. But post 1970, we see a definite shift in how America has started treading the path of politics. For example, before the 1970s, political parties were the main game changers as far as elections and the electoral process was concerned. The individual candidate did not matter. The political party did. But all that changed when millions of women entered the voting process and started voting for the individual and not the party. What this has ensured is that now policies are formulated keeping the gender question in mind. In fact, women are no longer simply voters. They are participating more actively and in an informed manner in the electoral process, whereby they are contesting elections to hold offices so as to bring about positive changes around them. The entire process of women gaining the right to vote in America has kind of redesigned the gender equation. Men and women are now renegotiating the boundaries that actually kept them separate. What was earlier considered as the private realm has now become public enough to affect not only women in America but also the men. The entry of women into the electoral process in America has completely changed the political process. As mentioned earlier, it is no longer party-centric. It is now more about the individual and what he can offer to his voters. This is by no means any insignificant change. It has made women the most powerful agent in bringing about a positive change in the political and social scenario of America. While the people of most of the nations worldwide prefer to call their homeland as their motherland, the people of Germany call their homeland as their fatherland. Yet, what is interesting to note here is the fact that the present Chancellor of Germany is a woman who is slowly changing the entire political scenario of Europe. So what is it about Germany that makes it different in spite of being hyper-patriarchal in character? What is interesting about Germany is the fact that ever since its unification, the various social groups in both East and West Germany have interacted on a scale which has given rise to many new ideas which cannot be termed as only feminist or socialist or liberal in character. The women's group in Germany, for example, took up the case of the guest workers and their children who were mostly born and raised in Germany. These guest workers who came from other neighboring countries did not have basic rights, for example, the right to vote or the right to receive dole money. Their issue was taken up by the social groups of Germany not as a feminist issue but as a humanitarian issue. That is why there is a basic difference in the way German feminist groups look at and approach social problems. They are not generally assigned gender-specific roles. Women in Germany especially believe in networking to create awareness about social issues. What is unique about Germany is the fact that instead of putting stress on the party or the group, it is more about one-to-one interaction and sharing personal experiences to try and locate the problem and find answers to it. For example, let's take up the issue of sexual harassment in workplaces. In Germany, this problem was addressed not by a movement or by taking to the streets. Rather, the women started a signing campaign over the social network to garner support for their cause. Women in Germany have always had equal opportunity to participate in the political process. In fact, if we look at the present government of Germany, right from the Chancellor to other important ministers, are women of not only education but also a long history of political awareness. What we can say is that, unlike the other European nations, Germany has truly displayed gender equality as far as its political process is concerned. Yes, there have been issues of reserving seats for women not only in the government but also in companies which operate in and out of Germany. But these are small ship issues compared to the fact that Germany is perhaps the only nation among the European countries which granted women the right to participate in the political process on an equal footing. Thus, what we have to keep in mind while thinking about the effect of women's franchise on the electoral process is the social makeup of the nation in question. Thus, what we can finally say is that women's participation in the political process is important because then only can there be a balanced worldview, and that is the only way by which we can make the governments of our nations realize the needs of nearly 50% of the population.